And our topic today will relate to something that I specialize in also, which is refuting the claim that we are a Christian nation or we are a nation founded upon religion. Our guest speaker today has held numerous positions in various different free thought organizations. He was, from 2000 to 2003, the executive director of our own Council for Secular Humanism at our headquarters in Amherst, New York. Then he was president of American Atheists. He also is very courageous in that virtually all of his life has been spent promoting atheism and church-state separation, literally in the belly of the beast, the south of the United States. So please join me in welcoming one of the true champions and heroes of contemporary atheism and secularism, Dr. Ed Buckner.
It's a delight and an honor to be here. It's a delight and an honor to get introduced by such a distinguished leader and to share the work that we're doing with Jim Underdown. You folks, I hope you're not taking this place for granted. The Center for Inquiry West or Los Angeles or whatever you're calling it these days is just a wonderful place, and it's very much needed. I know Eddie made reference to the fight in the South, and we certainly do still have a major fight to play, to engage in the South. But I've been in Los Angeles for 24 hours or so, and I've seen a few little bits and pieces of things that need attention here. I'm sure this is no surprise to any of you. But this Center for Inquiry and the work that Jim Underdown and his staff do is vital. And I hope that all of you, I know that many of you are major supporters of it. I hope you will continue that support and enlarge it. It very much deserves your attention and your support. Today, Jim Underdown and I are going to answer some questions, give you some information. A fair amount of it is probably information you're already familiar with, but you need to have it reinforced because you need to be the education warriors with letters to the editor and arguments at the water cooler and all the rest. We're going to talk about a lot of details, and I have more details than I can possibly talk about. So if you want to hear about, the president and the Baptist preacher and the big cheese, from Cheshire, asked me about that. I'm not going to bring that up unless somebody asks me. If you want to hear about the slave plantation in Barbados and what that has to do with any of this, you can ask me about that. I'm probably not going to bring that up either. I'm going to talk about lots of things, but there is one question that's crucial, that's very, very important, that I don't have an answer to and that I'm going to ask you to help me with. It's probably more important than any of the questions that I will answer or that you may ask, and I need your help on it. Jim and I are seriously considering a book to address this problem, and we need help. So I'll tell you about that when we get to the end. First, I want to give you what I hope is a very shortened version of the basic argument in favor of secularism, the history, the logic, and why this is the core of American exceptionalism, despite what other people claim is the core of American exceptionalism. It's crucially important to me. My son and I wrote a book about it. I hope you'll buy the book. But more important than buying it, I hope you'll read the book. I want you to be informed, and I think you deserve, and the world deserves to have you be an informed person on these items. If you have given all your money to the Center for Inquiry or plan to and can't afford to buy the book, it's available in lots of libraries, including the Los Angeles Library. So you can read it even if you don't buy it. You get it cheap on whatever those services are, and it's actually in some Barnes & Nobles. If you buy it today, you have a choice. It's an $18 book. If you buy it today, you can get it for $15 if you want it signed. There's a discount for anybody who's willing to feed my ego. And we have six copies. The first six people in line can actually get it signed by my son and co-author, as well as by me, because I brought those with me, and he already signed them. The title of the book, thank you, I planted that question. I'm glad we got it out. The title of the book is In Freedom We Trust, An Atheist Guide to Religious Liberty. And the word atheist in the subtitle is a touch misleading. It was put there because Paul Kurtz, who was still alive then, and Prometheus Books said, we want atheist in the title somewhere because it helps us to sell books. Who knew? But it is an atheist guide in the sense that it is from an atheist perspective, and we make no bones about it. We are atheists, and we are thoroughgoing atheists, my son and I. But the book is not a book to promote atheism, and we don't. We give you some other authors and titles to read if you want to learn more about atheism, but that's not the purpose of this book. The purpose of the book is to defend secularism, and there is a difference. Now, sometimes the word secular means the same thing as the word atheist sometimes means, but with respect to the American government, they are not the same, and the distinction is very important. A secular government is one which operates without respect to religion or religious principles. It does not promote atheism. It does not promote frou-frou New Age, whatever it was Eddie was telling me about that he's so enamored with, or maybe it was the governor. I'm not sure. Anyway, it promotes religious individual freedom, and the individual part is crucially important. So the book deals more with history than with logic, but with some of both, and I'm going to touch on them very briefly. How many of you have watched any of the series on the Roosevelts on PBA? Ah, good. All of it. Excellent. Well, then it's an interesting, I've only watched about half of it. We've taped it, and we're watching it. It's really interesting. Very well done. Ken Burns does a very good job. The best user of still photographs in the world. He's amazing at his ability to zoom in or zoom out on a still photograph and make that whole scene come alive for you. But he left out something, and he shouldn't have left it out. There is one president in the history of the United States that we know for sure did not get sworn in using a Bible and did not add, so help me God, after he was sworn in. And that was Theodore Roosevelt, who was sworn in after McKinley was assassinated in Buffalo, New York. No, Paul Kurtz didn't have anything to do with it. He was sworn in the home of a friend of his, Ansley Wilcox, who was from Georgia. So obviously it's a connection for me. He was born in Somerville, Georgia, the same part of Georgia that I live in now. And Ansley Wilcox didn't have a Bible in his house. And they had the swearing in at his house rather than the house where McKinley lay dying, because, or had just died, because he didn't want to insult the widow in the memory of the recent president. And they couldn't find a Bible. So I think it was just an accident that they didn't use a Bible. I don't think they were trying to make a point, but they didn't use a Bible, and the inauguration stuck. And they read him the official words that are in the Constitution, which don't have any God stuff in there, and it didn't have so help me God, and he didn't add it. He added something about, and I certainly swear to this, he added something of his own, but it was not anything religious. I don't think Teddy Roosevelt was an ideal champion of religious liberty, or, I mean, he called Thomas Paine a dirty little atheist and did some other stupid stuff. But in this case, he gave us an example that actually Christianity is not connected to our Constitution or to how we swear in our presidents. There's some serious controversy, some real controversy over whether Washington added those words even at the original inauguration. We don't have film of that. That could be why there's a problem. In any case, this country is a free country, not a Christian nation, and that matters. It matters to the Christians, and the point that the book and everything else I'm trying to do is to try to persuade because I believe it completely to be true that the secularism I'm defending is in the best interest of the fundamentalist Christian, of Eddie Tabash, and of everybody in between, and that's a wide, wide gulf. But all of us have a great deal at stake when you're talking about individual religious liberty. And so I'm going to give you four principles, is maybe a little too glorified, four ideas that I think are quintessentially important to American secularism, and that I want you all for a moment to pretend to be fundamentalist Christians. For some of you, this may be a little more difficult than for others, and for all of you, it'll probably be at least a little bit difficult. But pretend you're a fundamentalist Christian, and ask yourself, and maybe even say out loud when I finish, whether you disagree with any of these four ideas. Because I think if you agree with all four, and I think you will, even if you're a fundamentalist Christian, then I think you will say, well, okay, yeah, we should have a secular government. Idea number one is Americans, and for the moment we're going to be very provincial. We're not going to talk about the Canadians or the Mexicans or the people in Scotland or any other part of the United Kingdom. Americans don't agree on religion. We have very important, very sharp differences on religion. Some of us believe there is a God, some of us don't. I'm definitely one of the ones who does not. Some of us believe that this God needs to be worshipped in a particular way, or that he is one in three persons, et cetera, et cetera. You are all very, as Americans, you're very familiar with the fact that there are a rich and interesting, but at times deadly, variety of ideas on religion. The second major idea, besides that Americans don't agree on religion, is that human judgment is fallible. Now, I didn't say anything about divine judgment. Obviously, I'm an atheist. I don't believe there is a divine, so I don't believe he or she or it can have a judgment. But even for those who do, this is not irrelevant to whether God is perfect. It's only human beings have imperfect judgment. We make mistakes. We make big mistakes. We make mistakes in who we elect to office. We make mistakes in laws that we support. We change our minds about whether prohibition is a good thing or a bad thing, as a nation and as individuals. We make mistakes. Human judgment doesn't always work. It's not to be completely trusted. The third idea or group of ideas is that religious truth, this is more true of religious truth than it is of other kinds of truth. To some extent it's true of all kinds, but especially religious truth, cannot be determined by vote or by force. If everybody in this room except you said Orthodox Judaism is the right way to go, and you should go to Saturday school and become an Orthodox Jew, you still would not think that was right, even if you were outnumbered 99-1. I know there are 100 people here or not, probably not, but it's okay. We'll pretend there are. And that's true in every group of Americans you find, not just this group. So if the people in Cobb County, Georgia, want to vote that Protestant Christianity is the way, the truth, and the life, I don't have to pay any attention to them. And just the fact that they vote on it doesn't make it true. And the fourth idea, the most basically American of these ideas, is that individual religious liberty is worth protecting for its own sake. Never mind whether it's practical or valuable or will enrich society, anything. It's just a brute fact. It's worth protecting. Religious liberty at the individual level is crucially important to protect. Now, if you think all four of those ideas make sense, then you just cannot, in my opinion, in good conscience, support a government that will have the governor telling the citizens of the state that they have to be good Christians, or that they have to be good spiritualists or good meditators or anything else. It's none of the governor's business. It's too important to leave it up to the government. It's not that religious matters don't matter. I think they matter in a whole different way than some other people think they matter. But they're not in the purview of the governor or the teacher or any other representative of the government. And they shouldn't be in the courthouse, etc. 1776, we started a war. We won our independence. 1781 or 82 or 83, somewhere along in there, depending on which thing you use as the ending point, we finished up that revolution. And we started governing ourselves in all regards under the Articles of Confederation. We did not have, at that time, the Constitution, which, as Jim pointed out earlier, the anniversary of that Constitution was just this past week, and that was in 1787 that it was proposed. It wasn't until 1789 that it was finally put into place, ratified, and then put into place. The Articles of Confederation did not have a First Amendment. They didn't have much ceremonial religious language, but there was a little hint of some of that. The Constitution of the United States, which was, in fact, adopted a few years later, and 13 or 14 years, or 15, depending on how you count it, after the Revolution started, doesn't have any. That my favorite thing to say to a Christian who says, well, it may not say anything about Jesus Christ in the Constitution, but we were founded on Christian principles. Like what? Name one. It just isn't there. If you actually read the Constitution and not what some preacher says is in the Constitution, there are no biblical Christian principles incorporated into the Constitution. There are ideas that can be traced back to Judaism and Christianity, which can also be traced back to eras before Judaism and Christianity. There are things that, accepting slavery as a legitimate institution or accepting the idea that women should not be allowed a political vote, a vote or a voice, those are things that were enshrined in our Constitution and are also supported very well by the Christian Bible and by the Torah and so forth. But you can't blame Judaism or Christianity for those things. They existed before those religions came along. And you also can't blame the Constitution for it. Unfortunately, we've removed at least most of the formal trappings of this racism and sexism and support for slavery from our Constitution. And to go back to the history lesson, we had the Constitution. Then a few years after, that was 1787, 89, when George Washington was in his second term, we were having some problems with Islamic terrorists. You did know that that's been going on for a long time, right? We really were. The Barbary pirates were going around impressing our seamen and making slaves out of them. And actually, John Adams and Thomas Jefferson were warned in 1786, I think it was, when we were a country but not yet under the Constitution, that war with Islam was a bad idea because a war between Muslims or between Christians was a different thing. If you had a war between Islam and Christianity, it was much worse. They made people into slaves, and it was a horrifying, terrible thing. We didn't have a navy, or not much of one, and Washington was still president. It was very near the end of his second term, and on November the 4th, 1796, Washington left office the next year. We, the United States of America, agreed to a treaty with the Bey and people of Tripoli. And Article 11 of that treaty says, as the government of the United States was not in any sense founded on the Christian religion, goes on to reassure the Muslims in Tripoli, now the city-state that is more or less now Libya, we're not going to be engaged in a war with you over religion. It's been argued that we agreed to such a treaty because we were militarily weak and couldn't do much of anything else. We were trying to keep them off our back, whatever. The treaty didn't work very well. Four years later, we were at war with these folks. You've heard of the shores of Tripoli to the halls of Montezuma and the Marine Hymn, etc. Under President Jefferson, we did, in fact, come up with, Jefferson was a pacifist, but he built up a pretty good-sized navy, and we won naval battles that secured our freedom in this regard. You can argue all day about whether it's a good or a bad thing to have to do things militarily, and I'm not an expert and don't know. But I do know that this treaty was an important historical reminder of the fact that the Constitution does not include religious principles, and it's explicit about not doing so. I would like to kind of cut it off. We have invited some members of the press to this meeting to ask some tough questions, and I don't know if the reporter, Jim, I didn't catch your name, sir.
Ed Levy, Dayton, Tennessee, Times.
Yes, all right.
I'm holding a dollar bill right here, and it says right there, "In God we trust, Father of our country's on the front, God's on the back." What do you say about that?
So it looks just like this?
I can't see all the way there, yeah.
Well, I mean, it's got George Washington on the front, and on the back, it says, "United States of America, $1, annuit captus, novus aurum." I'm no Latin scholar, as you can tell. The great seal of the United States. Is that what you're talking about?
No, mine says, "In God we trust."
Well, mine doesn't, so I win. It doesn't. If you and the audience pull your dollar bills out, unless you're like me and mark it off on all of them, they probably do say, "In God we trust." This one doesn't, because it goes back to the 1930s, and even in the 1950s, paper money did not have "In God We Trust" on it. That is not a motto that was adopted by the framers of the Constitution or the founders of this nation. There was a committee to decide on the national motto. Benjamin Franklin was on that committee. I forget, there were two others. I think Adams was one, but I'm not sure. They actually considered a motto that included the word God and a religious reference, an indirect one, and they rejected that motto, and they chose instead the motto "Me Pluribus Unum." Again, I don't know how to pronounce Latin, Greek, etc. But that means "out of the many, one," and it does not have any kind of religious allusion to religious authority or religious support. And the beginning of this country, we did not have that. We got "In God We Trust" on our paper money, thanks to McCarthy and the big red scare in the 1950s. We were determined to show the world that we were not like those godless atheist communists over there in Russia. That was a mistake, not necessarily to fight against them, I don't mean that, but to identify what was important about them as their godlessness. We are a godless country and always have been, by which I don't mean we preach or promote atheism, but that we preach and promote secularism. You leave it up to the individual. Eddie wants to have a God, Eddie can have a God. But the governor and the president don't get to tell him what to do. We had several other reporters here.
Can I make a follow-up?
Go ahead.
Because, all right, so maybe it doesn't say it on your bill,
yeah,
but the pledge, it certainly says one nation under God. All our school children say that.
Yeah,
so
that goes back to the same era. The pledge, as originally proposed by a minister, interestingly enough, did not, and a socialist. I don't know, maybe those two things are not so incompatible, but some people think they are. I've forgotten his name, Bellamy, I think. He did not have "under God" in it. And the pledge, as originally, it actually went through several additions or changes before it got to where I had to learn it when I was in junior high. But when I learned it in junior high, it was one nation indivisible, and there was nothing dividing that one nation indivisible. And then while I was in junior high, showing you my age here, they changed it to divide up the indivisible part and put "under God" right in the middle of it. And I certainly think that was a mistake and unconstitutional. And Michael Newdow almost made him eat those words. Didn't quite get there. But.
Okay, so for those of us who weren't around in the 50s, excuse me.
Oh, you're going to rub it in. All right. Smart ass.
Then let's go back a little bit farther. Even in the Declaration of Independence, it says, endowed by their creator.
Yep.
I think creator means God, if I'm not mistaken.
Well, it goes on to say in the Declaration of Independence, nature is God, and it is clear if you know your history. And all these people know their history, but maybe you don't, Mr. Reporter. It's clear if you know your history that the allusions to God in the Declaration of Independence were ambiguous, were clearly not Christian allusions. They were, in fact, allusions to a God, but it was much more of a deistic God. The important thing to remember, the Declaration of Independence is a terribly important document. It has inspired people worldwide. It is something that American school children do learn about and should, but it is not our governing charter. It was a declaration before we went to war and before we organized the nation that we have now. And the Constitution of the United States is our governing charter, and that's what matters, not the Declaration of Independence, when it comes to things like this.
Okay, well, I'm glad you brought that up.
I'm glad I did, too. We didn't rehearse this, by the way, in case the cracks show through.
Let's talk about the Constitution.
Oh, let's do.
It says, in the year of our Lord on the Constitution.
Indeed it does.
Lord, to me, that's not even that... deistic.
Nothing ambiguous about that,
no,
right?
No, that's Lord, and it's not even deistic. I mean, when I think
Lord, it's a Christian allusion.
Yeah, okay. Exactly.
But it is a Christian allusion in the same sense. It's a conventional dating technique. All the formal documents of that day and age were dated in the year of our Lord, all of them, in the U.S. and in Great Britain and in the Western world. And I just want to ask you, we are here gathered today on a Sunday. How many of you regularly worship the sun? How many Americans regularly worship the sun? I'm not talking about the nudists who go out and enjoy being in the sun. That's not what I mean. I'm talking about the people who actually bow down to and say prayers to the sun. The name of this day of the week is an artifact of a previous religious belief, a belief in worshiping the sun. And it's not particularly unique in that regard. Tomorrow is Monday. That's worshiping the moon. The next day is worshiping a Norse goddess, I think, Tiu. Maybe that's a god. I can't remember. Woden's Day comes next. Thor's Day comes after that. Freya's Day is the one after that. And Saturn's Day is the last day of the week. So all of the days of the week are named after some religious entity that we no longer worship. And many of the names of the months are equally named after historical artifacts, things that are no longer significant. The dating of the Constitution, first of all, they went further. They didn't stop with the standard in the year of our Lord. They also dated it in the 13th year of our independence, 14th, I can't remember how they put it, or 12th. They were trying to establish a new dating system. It didn't work out very well. Nobody uses that dating system. But it was just a dating convention. And what matters is not what they put in the dating at the end, but what they put in the body of the Constitution. No invocation. It doesn't begin in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, although there was an organization, the NRA, National Reform Association, that tried to get it amended and actually introduce bills in the 1890s into the U.S. Congress to amend the Constitution so that it would say in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Those amendments failed. The Constitution of the United States does invoke the ultimate authority, though. It starts with we the people, and that is far more important than the dating at the end. Mr. Reporter, you give up yet?
No, I'm not even halfway there. All right, you want something specifically Judeo-Christian. Let's talk about in the Supreme Court building, the Ten Commandments. How can you be more specific than that are posted in the Supreme Court building?
Well, if they were, maybe you could argue that you couldn't be more specific. And there is a possible interpretation, but you got to know the whole story and not just part of the story. I've been in the Supreme Court building, and I know some of you have as well. If you go into the main courtroom, on the right-hand side, there is a sculptural frieze that includes Solon, I'm not sure how you pronounce that, Hammurabi, I never will remember how to pronounce it, even if you correct me. Hammurabi and Moses, who holds something that looks very much like the Ten Commandments with some Hebrew scribbling on it a little bit. Nothing you can read, even if you understand Hebrew, but just something that's obviously a sculptural allusion to the Ten Commandments. And it has like 15 or 20 historical figures on that side. On the other side are more recent lawgivers. Those are ancient lawgivers. On the other side are more recent lawgivers, such as Muhammad and Napoleon. But Jesus isn't on either side, and there is not a religious allusion there. It's an allusion to the sources of law. And behind the over the heads of the justices, there is a monumental frieze of a muscular-looking Roman with his elbow sitting on a tablet that has some Roman numerals on it that have been interpreted as maybe 1 through 10. It's just 5, 6, and 7 or something. Oh, that's for the Ten Commandments. It could just as easily be the Bill of Rights. And in fact, on the doors leading into the chamber are two wooden plaques, carvings, that don't have any words on them, but they have the Roman numerals 1 through 10. And the docent will tell you that stands for the Bill of Rights, Amendments 1 through 10. The building was built in 1935. It has nothing to do with the framers of the Constitution. A.A. Weinemann was the main architect and artist who did all of this. He designed the Mercury Dome and the Walking Liberty Half, so he's important to us numismatists. But he happened to be Jewish, so it's pretty good a chance he didn't put Christian allusion in there. But he didn't put any allusion that religion is the source that we have to follow. It just meant there are all kinds of strands that come together to give us the majesty of the law.
Well, I think that the people who would disagree, let's talk about real fundamentals here.
Yeah.
I mean, who originally started populating this country, pilgrims and other people seeking religious freedom, these were religious people who came to our shores to practice their religion specifically. That's obviously a foundation of religious belief.
You might even throw in, I don't know, the Mayflower Compact? Or
exactly.
While we're at it. They did, and part of our history, part of our culture, part of the development of our society, part of it does include people who were Christians and who were seeking religious liberty for themselves as individuals. Robert E. Lee, since I'm not in the South, but I'm a Southerner, I'll tell you, Robert E. Lee wrote to his wife what a terrible thing it is that the people who came from other lands to establish religious liberty, as soon as they got here and got in power, seemed less interested in such matters. But these people did come seeking, but they sought individual religious liberty. They did not come seeking, at least originally, to establish a nation that was forcing this. And let's talk about, since I brought it up, I meant for Jim to bring it up. I brought up the Mayflower Compact. The Mayflower Compact was an important historical document. It was one of the first in human history where a group of people voted on governing themselves in the Plymouth Plantation Mayflower Compact, Massachusetts, as it is now. But obviously we don't accept the things they said in that Mayflower Compact as governing. First of all, they go back a hundred or a couple of hundred years, 160 or whatever, before the Constitution of the United States. Secondly, the very first thing it says in the Mayflower Compact is that we promise forever to worship and obey our sovereign Lord King James. Now, you know, I don't know about the rest of you, but whether you're Scottish or not, you don't do that anymore. We rebelled against that. So these strands of our history are important. We need to know about them. We need to understand them and study them. But don't mistake them for establishing that this is a Christian nation. It's a Christian nation in the sense that a majority of the people in the country nominally in some way call themselves Christians. They mean all kinds of different things by it. But a majority of the people in this country are women. We don't call it a female nation. Majority of the voters are women, and if they chose to, they actually could take a long time. They could amend the Constitution to take away men's vote. Maybe they should. I'm not sure.
Well, it seems to me, this tradition is continuing on strongly. You have the Hobby Lobby decision recently, and another recent Supreme Court decision saying that any city council could open up with a explicitly Christian prayer if they wanted to. So it's alive and well, these ideas.
They are alive and well, and I think the Supreme Court made a very bad decision in the Hobby Lobby decision for lots of reasons, and in the Greece-New York prayer decision. What they actually decided in the Greece-New York decision is that and I think they were wrong, but they decided if they have invocations and if they're open to anyone, then it can be interpreted that it's not the government endorsing a particular religion. And the answer to that, in my opinion, is for atheists and secularists of all sorts to ask for permission to give invocations. In Los Angeles in November, and I don't have the exact date with me, Indra Zuno, who is on the board of American Atheist and who lives here in Los Angeles, she fought for a year to get this privilege, but she's going to give a secular invocation in Los Angeles. I don't even remember which body it is, but if you find out about it, go hear her. She's a wonderful spokesperson for our movement. I've given an atheist invocation in Cobb County, Georgia, which was extremely well received. They wanted me to run for governor, but...
Run from the governor.
What?
Or run from the governor.
Yeah, it might have been run from the governor. I'm not sure. I might have got that wrong. I don't agree with that decision, but the decision was not that this is a government of Christians for Christians. It was a decision that we can be a secular government and still allow this particular freedom for individual Christians without getting it entangled with the improper use of government force. I don't agree with them, but they didn't actually rule what the opponents claim they ruled.
Okay, well, maybe one last question here. I mean, this is a democracy, majority rules. It's clearly a majority of Christians in this country. If you don't like the position of the majority, people like you, why don't you just move back to Russia?
Okay. That, he's making fun, and that's his job. But I went into, you're talking about the South. In Minnesota, I went to give a talk somewhat similar to this some years ago in Minneapolis. And a woman, they had a placard out front that Ed Buckner is going to speak on this, not a Christian nation. And a woman greeted me at the door an hour or so before the event was supposed to start and asked me just that. She really did say I should go back to Russia. And it wouldn't have mattered to her if I could have convinced her, which is the truth. I've never been to Russia and don't, as far as I know, don't have any ancestral. I got a huge mix of ancestral threads, but I don't think any of them go back to Russia. First of all, to the extent that Russia had a secular government, and they had one very, very badly flawed, mostly for reasons not dealing with their atheism and their secularism, it was something they inherited from us, not the other way around. They actually did have separation of church and state in the Constitution, but they borrowed the idea from Thomas Jefferson, not the other way around. It is a quintessentially American idea, not just with regard to religion and secularism. It's a quintessentially American idea that an individual has rights that cannot be taken away by a majority. Not just religious rights, but other kinds of rights as well. That's what the Bill of Rights is all about, really, is supporting individual and minority rights. It's the majority that the Founding Fathers had more fear of in some ways than they did of a particular tyrannical government. We are not a democracy in the sense that a simple majority vote decides things. We are a democratic republic, and we're more democratic than we used to be. We used to didn't even elect senators. We elected state representatives who in turn elected U.S. senators. But in any case, we are not and never have been a society or a government that would allow individual rights to be taken away by the majority. So to that person, I would say, can't go back to where I've never been, and that includes metaphorically as well as geographically. We've run out of reporters, but we probably haven't run out of questions. First, I'd like to deal with, if you have heard in a letter to the editor or at the water cooler or someplace else, something that somebody said where they made a point that you thought they thought was legitimate, even if you didn't necessarily think was legitimate, ask me about that, and let's see if we can't talk about it. You can ask any question you want to other than the boxers or brief stuff. Got any? And I'm going to ask you a question after we see if you have any questions. No inquisitive people here. Yes, okay. I can't see very well the lights in my... That's fine.
As I recall in the early history of the United States, I guess prior to it being the Constitution being written, that in fact different areas of the country were established actually for different religions, right? I mean, it was Maryland, it was Catholic, I believe, and so on. What was the variety? And that had to be, I mean, is part of the decision to write the Constitution the way it was based on the fact that they couldn't agree on these issues?
Part of it. The point he was making, in case you didn't hear what he said, is that before there was a United States of America, there were separate individual colonies, some of which, most of which, did have a religious basis, at least as far as the official establishment went. And you had, South Carolina had a provision, it's still in the Constitution, but it's been ruled unconstitutional by the South Carolina Supreme Court. That's another interesting story, that said you have to be a believer in God in order to hold elected office. There were state constitutional or charter provisions that specified... That's a good idea. Let there be light. There were state charter provisions that said you had to be a Protestant Christian to hold office or to vote or what have you. There were all kinds of provisions, and they varied, as you said in your question. Some were I don't think even Maryland, which was more Catholic than not and was founded by a Catholic leader, was not, I don't think, completely a Catholic colony, but it had more tolerance and acceptance of Catholic rights than Georgia did, for sure. There was considerable disagreement among these different colonies, but when the Constitution of the United States was established and the First Amendment said the Congress shall make no law respecting the establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof, that did only refer to the national government. Now, it implied very clear implication that it was not merely the legislative branch, but also the executive branch. The federal government doesn't get to mess around with religion, and you as an individual U.S. citizen, the federal government cannot take your religious rights away from you, whether you're part of the establishment in your particular colony or not. The religious establishment survived that period. And it survived all the way up to 1868 when the 14th Amendment was passed. The 14th Amendment was passed largely because of the Civil War and the late unpleasantness, as we call it in Georgia, after the War of Northern Aggression. And that amendment specified that the citizens of the United States, their citizenship and their rights as a citizen cannot be abridged by any government, local, state, or federal. And actually, the establishments of religion had all been voted out before you got to that point, the official ones. Jefferson wrote not too long before his death to Adams, congratulating him on the fact that some of the religious establishments in New England had been voted out. The last state to lose its religious establishment was that arch-conservative right-wing colony known as Massachusetts. It was a 10-to-1 vote of the people to overturn the establishment of the Congressional Congregational Church, which until that point was the official church of Massachusetts and actually had rights and privileges before the law that other churches didn't and so forth. And they could raise tax revenue to support the church. That was voted out by the citizens of Massachusetts, and that was the last one. There were some before that that were voted out. Connecticut is the one that was that Jefferson referred to in his letter to Adams. So before we had a United States, we had established religions in the colonies. They survived formally and officially in some regards until 1868. They're still on the books in many of these state constitutions, but they are unenforceable as being on the books. Herb Silverman went to a considerable length to prove this and succeeded. I can tell you his story. He tells it much better than I do. His book, Candidate Without a Prayer, is a very good read. Yes, sir.
Religious institutions, buildings, et cetera, enjoy the protection of city fire and police and whatever, and yet pay no taxes to support those. Do you have any extra opinions on that?
Yeah, I think it sucks. That's my formal and official opinion. I'll elaborate a little bit. First of all, and if you didn't hear what he said, churches, temples, mosques, and other religious institutions get paved streets in front of them. They get police and fire protection. They get the benefits of government services, same as other organizations do. They are taxed differently in different jurisdictions and in different ways. There's also the question of whether their income is subject to tax. They are, in that regard, similar, but not the same, and the difference is very important. Similar and not the same as the American Red Cross or American Atheist or other nonprofit organizations. American Red Cross, American Atheist, the Center for Inquiry, and other organizations of that sort are 501c3 organizations. That means that under the laws of the Internal Revenue Code, you can give money to the Center for Inquiry. You were thinking about doing that, right? You can give money to the Center for Inquiry, and you can take a deduction on your taxes. So if you're in the top tax bracket and you give $100,000 to the center, which I think some of you are planning to do soon, that will not cost you $100,000 because you'll save some money on your taxes that will offset that. It can be a fairly substantial sum, and it makes a difference. Well, you think, oh, well, that's the same as churches. What's the problem? The difference is Jim and the folks in Amherst, New York, have to account for that money. They have to file a Form 990, say where the funds are spent, at least in a general way. They're subject to audit. They are accountable. If it's the Cathedral of the Angels or whatever it is and here in Los Angeles, they don't have to account for it. And that means they don't have to account for it at all. And some churches do require, or their members require them to account for things, so we know how they spend their money. But they don't have to account to the government, and they can even use it to do things that are considered illegal, like support political candidates. It's hard to believe that any church would support a political candidate, but they do all the time. And there's lines that are hard to draw and so forth. If you allow a candidate to speak at your services, is that a violation? Generally speaking, it's been ruled not to be one. But there are all sorts of privileges that are given to religious institutions that are not given to other nonprofit organizations, and they are blatantly unfair, unconstitutional. When and if the Supreme Court ever gets a case that accurately tests these privileges, and if they rule based on the U.S. Constitution, those privileges will be lost, and they should be.
Let me add two of those privileges. Chaplains and priests get housing allowances that I do not get as position. We pay $30,000 a year in taxes and property taxes on this building. The Church of Scientology, which owns prime street front all up and down Hollywood, pays $0 a year in property taxes.
Yeah. Property taxes are a matter of state and local laws and rules, so they vary. And there are churches that do pay property taxes in this country. Most of them don't. Most of them do not, especially in conservative places like Los Angeles and Georgia. But in New York City, there are churches that have paid property taxes. There is the income tax is a national thing. The state and property taxes, in general, with some minor exceptions here and there, are local matters. The income tax provisions on things like housing allowance for pastors, That is a national thing, and it's there are all kinds of advantages. And I have heard, I've got a very good friend who lives in the adjoining county. His name is Ryan Hale. He's a big church state supporter. He's a leader of Americans United for Separation of Church and State. But he thinks that it's a good idea to have the clergy housing allowance because a lot of churches are struggling and their minister has a day job and this is just a small part-time thing and it gives them a little help and it would deprive them of a right. And I don't accept what he says. It doesn't make sense to me. You can have a struggling organization devoted to all kinds of different causes and purposes, and the federal government should not give them support based on tax privileges that are not given to all. Now, I do believe in giving different tax privileges to nonprofit organizations, but I think there have to be accountability is the number one thing you have to have if you do that, and it should be the same for all of them. It's amazing. To get a church exemption, all you have to do is say, we're a church, leave us alone. They leave you alone. Sucks. That's what I started with. That's what I end with. Sucks.
Thank you for that.
The example that you just gave, they said, oh, this preacher has no money or he's just part-time. You know, they have all the theoreticians on their side, but they're the ones that are so powerful all the time, you know?
Yeah.
By the way, you mentioned in the beginning two little anecdotes, and I, for one, do want to hear them.
Sure. I don't know how much time we have. I can go on with my anecdotes for hours, but you may not can sit for hours and listen to them.
I could.
Okay.
I appreciate all of this. I mean, the examples you gave are very good for us because it does come up later on, allusions to God in the Constitution. It's no allusions to God.
That's right.
And I appreciate that, so I go by your son's book.
It's my book. I'm the first author.
Okay. Anyway.
But it's his book, too. And it is, it was a genuine collaboration. We both worked on it. I did more of the work than he did, but he did a lot. And he was working full-time. I was not.
I'm looking forward to it, yeah. Just one last thing. And I've actually brought it up before, and I have a lot of faith, secular atheist faith, in our leader, Jim. And I had brought in one there.
He's a con man. You should have confidence in him, not faith.
Anyway, I have seen people from the Mideast in demonstrations. One, when Erdogan first came to power, and he was suppressing people, and there was a park. This was last June, a year and a half. Anyway, and then also before Morsi was ousted, there were a bunch of Egyptians out here on Wilshire Boulevard in front of an embassy. And I here they were, not in that one, in that demonstration, I had been reading some of the LA Times where how Morsi was right-wing. And anyway, the people in that demonstration were secular, both, and the Erdogan was secular. And all I'm wondering, these were brown-skinned people on an international, and we could have gotten out there. I'm wondering, how do we reach out to those people?
Well, I have a lot of confidence in Mr. Underdown also, and I do think that this organization does need to reach out and have alliances with other secular people, but you got to pick and choose, and you got to choose what works best for your strategy and what works best with the limited resources that you have. And I don't know the answer in that particular case. I do think that the rights of Americans and of people in America to speak freely and say things that I disagree harshly with is very important, and I want them to keep that right. I think we should fight to make sure that they do. I don't. What was there? Something else? Some other anecdote?
Excellent.
All right. Okay.
Give us the anecdote.
Well, I'll give you a very, very quick version of it. Let's just start with Codrington Plantation in Barbados. In 1710, a very rich sugar plantation owner died. Christopher Codrington left his plantations to this organization, absentee landlords. They were in London. And they owned the plantations, and they kept details, specific records about the plantations and how they were operated. And they had a lot of concern about the slaves that were on the plantation because they died off at an extremely high rate, and it was expensive to replace them. So So they were very concerned about them. And they owned that plantation from 1710 until the 1830s, so over 100 years. The plantation was left to this organization so they could develop Codrington College, which is still there. And the organization that owned it, we know that they owned it because one of the things they did is their slaves, some of them at least some of the time, had the first word in the name of the organization on their chest. They were branded with the word society across their chest because they were owned by the Society for the Propagation of the Gospel in Foreign Lands. They were owned by the Church of England. And a priest in the Church of England in 1783 said, this is immoral and we should quit owning slaves. And they said, it's good business. You know, we're getting money from this. We need it. I don't know what they said, but they didn't stop owning the slaves. So that was one. And that ties into the big, big question that we face. And I'll get to that in a minute. But it's related to the fact that religious people frequently argue and even believe that morality and religiosity are positively correlated, causally correlated, and that therefore we cannot have a moral society unless we have a religious society. I'll get back to that a little bit more in a minute. I got some more questions here. I love questions. I'm going to hold your hands up if you want to ask a question. And I'm going to ask you to number off, and then I won't have to remember who asked what first. So you'll be number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. You remember that? I don't have to remember your number. You have to. Okay? All right. So question number 1.
Looking through the history, I'm thinking that religion very frequently is not a question, God does exist or doesn't exist, is he good or is he bad? But it's the use for domination of certain groups of people.
Of course.
Whether you believe in Sunday or Monday or whatever it is, they want to dominate in particular area and try to eliminate the opposition, disregarding whatever it is.
Well, I certainly agree with you. I'm not sure that's a question. But
yeah, you have a God which is communism, and we are eliminating those who are against us.
Human beings do have this tendency to want to control each other. To get more money, more power, more whatever. And religion has proved to be an extremely useful tool for that purpose. There's a famous quotation, I think it's from Fall of the Roman Empire, Edward...
Gibbons?
Yeah, Edward Gibbons. I think he's the one who said it, that the religion is useful for the politicians and the leaders, and he went on to name three categories. I don't remember exactly how the quote goes, but he makes it clear that this has nothing to do with the truth of religion. It has to do with its power, and it is certainly true that religion, and it's not the only, whether communism is a religion or not is a matter of how you define it in terms and so forth. You can make the case that it is. It is something that is held to have absolute truth that can't be questioned, and that makes it damn dangerous. And that's true of any ism, whether it's religion or not. So I don't know.
But in communism, you have the whole structure. The Communist Party is based on the Christianity. The Pope is elected. You have the cardinals with the election. The Pope has...
Sure,
directly. You cannot criticize him.
Yeah. Well, all human organizations have in common this ability to try to do things to give power to individuals and to give legitimacy to the principles that they are promoting. Religion has been extremely good at doing that. We have questioner number 2, whichever that was.
I'll phrase it as a question. One of the strongest advocates of the point you're making that you've not mentioned, I'm curious why, is Roger Williams.
Well, I just didn't happen to mention him. I'm certainly familiar with Roger Williams. I'm sure most of you know that Roger Williams left the Massachusetts Bay Colony and founded the colony in Rhode Island instead. Roger Williams was religious, but he did believe in religious liberty, and some people give him credit for developing the term separation of church and state. He actually said church and the garden, or he had a different word for it, but it was somewhat similar. And there are some interesting books about Roger Williams. He is certainly one of the philosophical forefathers of the Enlightenment ideas that helped to establish this country. So it's just an oversight that I didn't happen to mention him. Number three?
Yes. Could you comment on the current disinformation campaign, you know, the religiosity of the founding fathers? I'm thinking of, like, David Barton, who I'm sure you're familiar with.
He's an illegitimate son of a bitch. Let me see. No, maybe that's not.
No, precisely.
He is. Yeah, he pretends to be a historian. He is not. He is a promoter of a particular point of view, and he is not a legitimate promoter of that. He's very careless with his facts. We're talking about David Barton, wall builders, etc. He makes stuff up and doesn't back off of it very well, even when he's caught. He has made up or accepted other people's fabrication of quotations that support this sort of thing. If you listen to all of his stuff, you'll hear him including some quotations that are accurate but not relevant, some quotations that are not accurate, and some that we really can't have no way of testing. It's ultimately impossible to prove that James Madison never said, "Red is my favorite color." We don't have any record of him saying that. We can't prove he did say it. But the only way to prove that he never said it would be to have a complete transcript of his entire life. We don't have that for anybody, supposedly for Jesus. But anyway, we don't have a complete transcript. So quotations can be abused and misused with a great deal of ease, and they are, by people who don't have any respect for the truth or for their own fallibility with regard to quoting things. George Washington's alleged quote about the U.S. is founded on the Ten Commandments stuff is just almost certainly bogus, but it's kind of hard to prove that it's bogus. There's a Madison quote and a Washington quote along similar lines. They almost certainly did not say them. They're completely at odds with the things we know they did say, but it's very hard to prove they didn't say something like this. I have no respect for David Barton. I'd be happy to debate him. David Barton, are you watching this video? Let me know. I lost count of what number I'm on. Number four.
And if you address the value to society of social services provided by churches and what secularists may propose?
It's a good question. I like the quote from Nobel Prize winner Stephen Weinberg, I think his name was, he's at University of Texas, Austin. He says, "Religion is an insult to human dignity. With it or without it, good people would do good things, but it takes religion to get good people to do bad things." I'm paraphrasing him. It's something along those lines. I don't think that's exactly correct, but it is mostly correct. Churches throughout history, throughout American history, have done some good for their members and for their communities. To argue otherwise is naive and foolish. I would argue that they have done less good than they have done harm, and that you can do good by giving people soup and do harm at the same time by brainwashing them. But they've done some good. And I would argue that when a religious organization wants government funds to do some good, they should have to meet the same standards that any other agency has to meet in order to get those funds. And if you think this is just an academic question, the Catholic Charities, which you may be familiar with, according to their own website, this is not based on some left-wing Eddie Tabash thing. This is according to Catholic Charities' own website. They get 62% or 63% of their funding from government sources. And they only get about 9% from direct donations from their Catholic believers. So my question is not really, do they do any good? But my question is, are they really Catholic charities? They are charities that are supported by you and me. So they're American charities. Is that a good way for us to organize these services? I would argue probably not, but whether it is or not, when you take government money, you should have to meet public standards. You should not be allowed to discriminate against people because they're gay or because they're black or because they're women, in not discriminate in hiring or in service providing, and that sort of, and you should have to account for every damn dime of your money too. Now, it's foolish and naive to argue that churches don't do any good. And if you are talking to somebody who's trying to say they do some good, and you say no, they don't, then you'll lose the argument, and you should. That's not the argument you should have. You should have the argument as to how it is organized, funded, supported. I don't know if that gets at your question or not, but
I was just wondering what the constructive side of the secularist proposal is to replace that.
Well, I do think that we as a society have to come up with ways to organize our culture and our society and provide for our members. And I would like not for the Center for Inquiry, but for the U.S. government and for the government of California to solve problems. And to do that, I think, requires some tax revenues and some thoughtfulness. And I am a progressive Democrat and believe in government, but I am not an idiot. I don't by at all argue that government will automatically solve problems, or that you don't have to be aware of concentrations of power and misuse and so forth. So it is not something you should expect. If you go back and say, oh, they're wonderful, beautiful cathedrals in Europe, have you seen them? Yeah, I have. I love them. I like church architecture. And I think churches, religious Christians, created those buildings. But they were human beings that created it. They weren't gods that created it. They created it for what they thought were good religious reasons. I think they succeeded despite their religion, not because of it, or at least not exclusively because of it. I enjoy the buildings and the architecture and the way it looks. Was it worth it compared to what they could have done with that money? I have no way of knowing. I have a feeling it probably was not. All right, we stick with the numbers until we get through. And Jim, when I got 5 minutes left, let me know, because I want to make sure we get to the big final question. Okay. At the end, but I'll answer questions up until then.
Number five.
All right, number five.
You're
still in the top 10. That's worth something, right?
I'm lucky that way.
Yeah.
You alluded several times to Thomas Jefferson.
Yes.
As an and you said that he was a pacifist.
Oh, he was accused of being a pacifist in his day.
Well, that's what I'm trying to. I don't know much about him, but I don't know how he could be a pacifist if, as you say, he presided over.
Well, before he was elected, in his original election campaign, his opponents accused him of being a pacifist, and of, I don't know if they used the word pacifist, but of not being very militarily aggressive. He was the governor of Virginia for one term. And during that term, I think it was the Brits, came after him, and he ran away and escaped and was discredited in some people's minds for not standing and fighting. And, you know, so he had something of a reputation for not being all that courageous. But he still ordered the SEAL Team 6 to kill bin Laden. No, I'm mixing up two presidents, but there are, in fact, some interesting parallels between Obama and Jefferson, and some of them do relate to this notion of whether this guy is a, you know, right-wing imperialist military type or devoted to diplomacy no matter what. Yeah, Jefferson had a reputation, at least before he was elected, of being too quick to be diplomatic and not quick enough about being militaristic. Apparently proved him wrong, but he was also, there were newspaper articles in the day when Jefferson ran for president against Adams that said, you have a choice. You can vote for Adams and God or for Jefferson and atheism. And there were people who honestly believed that if Jefferson was elected, the federal government would go house to house and confiscate Bibles. They said these things during the campaign. Now, of course, it was baloney. Can you believe people would say things about the government that aren't true? Hard to believe. All right. Did I answer your question? All right. Number six.
I was just wondering if you could comment on like the founding fathers of the Constitution and all that, most of them were Freemasons, and I never hear you guys ever say anything about the Freemasons and their involvement in the framing of the Constitution.
I don't know. I knew a guy, Conrad Geringer, who was a member of an atheist branch of the Masons and who worked for American Atheists. He's dead now, so, and I don't. And Edwin Kagan also joined, at least briefly, with this atheistic branch of the Masons. He's dead, too, so I can't ask either one of them. I'm not an expert on that. I do know that George Washington was very big in the Masons, and so were some others. And there's a huge building in Alexandria, Virginia, that's dedicated to George Washington the Mason and so forth. Exactly how much that influenced their ideas and whether that, in fact, constitutes a kind of a religion, I don't know. I don't have the expertise to really answer your question, and I apologize for that. Next question I'm going to ignore. Yes?
Okay. Ignore mine. I'm number seven. We have, sitting on the Supreme Court, two people.
We don't have any Protestants.
Yeah, no Protestants.
Or atheists. Well, we probably
we do have two people who insist that they take all of their decisions based on what they call original intent. These are Scalia and his yes man, Thomas.
Yes.
And they wield very great power right now over the court in recent decisions.
Mm-hmm.
Can you think of, are there any strategies to counteract this influence?
There are. I give you Edward Tabash, who will explain exactly what we should do about this, right? I think probably the primary strategies are electoral, that we need to vote, run for office, demand of candidates for all sorts of offices, but especially for people who get to appoint Supreme Court justices. What's your position on these things? They matter. They matter a hell of a lot. They matter beyond the term of any particular president. I'm not sure what strategy will work. I think one strategy is not to rely on the Supreme Court to rectify all the wrongs that we see. We have to be active and involved to affect who gets on the Supreme Court, but also to affect what laws are passed and what actions are taken by the government. I think the strict intent originalists are utterly they don't make any sense. They cannot sustain that argument when you look at all the things that have changed, and I don't think the framers intended that. The framers obviously intended for their document to get changed. They allowed for amendments, and those amendments have radically changed the document in some very important ways. I mean, we actually let women vote. My God. And we don't allow slavery, and all kinds of important changes have occurred. The original intent folks say, well, if they're properly amended, then it's okay. Well, why isn't it okay in some other respects? Now, on the other hand, people who argue about original intent and constitutional principles do have a point that you have to have some basis for making decisions. You just can't have nine justices get together and make their own personal choice. I mean, I think that to some extent is what does happen, but you have to have the imprimatur of the Constitution and of a rational process that involves more than just personal prejudices. So it gets difficult and complicated, and I'm not an attorney, much less a constitutional scholar like Edward Tabash and Barack Obama. It's an argument that has sway with those two and to some extent with the rest of the court now, and it shouldn't. And what should we do about that? Get some presidents who will get some chances to appoint some better justices is one thing we should do. Make Edward Tabash a justice himself. That would be a good way to do it. Well, before we end it, I got to ask my question of you. And I know there were at least another couple of questions, and I'll be glad to try to answer them afterwards if we have time. The book that Jim and I are contemplating working on, you can buy in Freedom We Trust. It's comprehensive. It doesn't cover every single possible detail. There's not a single mention in it of Codrington Plantation for the simple reason that I had never read about that when we wrote the book. But it covers virtually all of the details about American history that get brought into all these arguments. And it does have a chapter in there on morality, and that's a crucial thing for talking about slavery. Almost all Americans today think slavery is immoral. But Christians did not think it was immoral for most of the history of Christianity, so that makes them not a reliable source for moral standards. And it certainly proves that they're not the holders of an unchanging set of moral standards. And that's an important point. The thing that we have not accomplished, despite the fact that we wrote this incredible book that you should memorize it. You should memorize this book. But despite that, and despite the fact that the book is in a variety of bookstores and libraries, there is still a vast unwashed, that's probably not the right word, there's a vast number of Americans. It might be 38% of them. It might be 73% of them. I don't even know whether it's a majority, but it's a large number who unthinkingly, unquestioningly assume that this is a Christian nation and that that's a good thing. That we should be, even if they're not Christians themselves, that we're better off if we all understand that this is a Christian nation and we're swaggering around the world in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and that's a good thing. And my question to you is similar to what somebody asked me about the Supreme Court. What should we do about that? Jim and I want to write a book. Jim is in charge of the lighthearted part. He is as knowledgeable as I am, but he's a stand-up comic. And he and I want to do a smaller, lighter, less, almost not documented book that makes the case that we make in our more scholarly book and get some chance to get on bookshelves and have some popularity. Now, what the chances are, I don't know. It's probably slim, but it's worth trying. So my question to you is, first of all, do you think that's even a good idea? Yeah. Do you have ideas about how to put this together? I'm assuming it should be short, punchy, not worry about the documentation other than maybe give a list of books that will document these things if you want to go read something that documents it, including ours, but including lots of others. And that it should have some comic bits, maybe not comic bits that go too far in making fun of the religious idiots, but comic bits that will allow them to laugh at these stupid ideas. So my question to you is, what should be in that book, and what should any of us do besides a book, because nobody reads anymore? In the back.
As a person that reads a lot of books...
You're a rare person.
I am.
I'm sorry to say.
Making references to read another book, I don't think, in my opinion, it's a good idea. Making it funny, people are not going to respect it. That's
the humor
idea.
Has to be very carefully done. It has to be done in a way that is not insulting to people that I'm trying to bring onto my side. I mean, you're right about that. But what was your point about not making reference to other books?
Right. If you say I'm making this statement based on this book, this page, published in, people are not going to go to get another book to understand what is it you are really trying to say on two lines.
Yeah. I think what we're going to try to do, and it's, I'm not sure we can do this. I don't know. I think we can, but I'm not sure. Is to have a book that makes the case, that makes the arguments, and that has enough, that refers to some historical stuff, but doesn't give footnotes and citations, and says at the back of the book, if you want to follow up on these kinds of things, here's a list of some of the books you can look at.
Yeah,
not don't blame me, blame these people, but something that gives somebody a way to look further if they want to look further. I mean, obviously the purpose of the original purpose that my son and I had was to do a book that would be comprehensive and that would make this case and get everybody to understand that the facts and the logic and the history, they're all on our side. We got all the info. And I still want to make that case, but I want to make that case in a way that people will hear me. They're not hearing me very well right now. A hell of a lot of people aren't. Maybe I should just, you know, use my $100 million fortune and buy some ads.
Maybe if you took it from an angle of things you thought were true.
Okay.
Yeah. Statements that you think were true, like, you know, there's a lot of scientific statements that people think are true, and they aren't. All you got to do is say, oh, well, that isn't true, and here's why.
Okay.
You're hearing this, Jim? Yeah, that sounds like a good idea. Others? Yes, sir. First you and then him.
First, I would suggest if you could think about, as you're making your book, that you could make a series of YouTube videos based on your book to reach a lot of people that way.
Okay.
And another one to reach.
That would definitely be more Jim's department than mine, but I'm okay with it.
And one other is, see if you can do something to reach out to kids, have a coloring book, some other things like that that are based on your book.
Something that says, your parents are full of shit, read this. No, I'm just... Oh, okay. All right, yeah.
By the way, part of the inspiration for Ed being here and for working on this whole project is a series of cartoons that are now available on the other side, which we would argue completely misrepresent American history and the founding and how that manifests itself, how religion manifests itself. Even today, so that's already happening on the other side. This is kind of in response to that.
Yeah, those cartoons are organized partly and maybe even mostly under the leadership of, and she doesn't like me to do this, so you got the tape still running or is it off now? Oh, okay. My wife's double cousin, she through her mother and his mother, my wife and Mike Huckabee are cousins twice over. Two sisters married two brothers. It's nothing incestuous. And so Mike Huckabee has all kinds of atheists in the woodpile and doesn't know about it. But anyway, he was one of the leaders of this. And it is, I think they call it Learn Our History. I'm not sure. You can sign up for an email service for free where they'll send you every week a list of interesting dates for this week in American history. And I've done that, and it includes all kinds of stuff, which is interesting. Today is the anniversary of the capture of Benedict Arnold and the proof that he was a traitor, and they give you some details about how Benedict Arnold was the head of the military academy, West Point, and was conspiring to turn it over to the Brits, and that was really important because the river... Hudson River mattered a lot to the colonies at the time, and the West Point controlled them. So they give you lots of historical details, most of which appear to be accurate, true, correct, possibly out of context, and some of them are incorrect because they collapse something down to a sentence or two, and that's not their fault. That's inevitable. Anytime you shrink something that took 3 years and 4,000 people to unfold and you put it in three sentences, you're going to misrepresent it. You can't do otherwise. But at times, and the thing that really started Jim off and got him in touch with me was the thing they did on the pledge where they implied that those evil atheists had required people to quit saying anything about God in school at all. And it was just a terrible thing, but the teacher was saying, you can still go read about some of this stuff, but be careful. You might get thrown in jail by the president. Nah, she didn't say that. But it was implicitly misleading and dangerously so. And there are plenty of examples of this, not just in this series, but in general. And David Barton is a wonderful exemplar of that evil trend. Other suggestions, or yes, sir?
while the basis of morality, religion is the basis of morality. I would like to see, let's say, a list of things where the principles of morality, which was presented by various religions,
yeah.
Christian religion, and their practice were very different.
Sure. Well, the idea that religiosity is a basis for morality is very old. It has been taught by preachers and theologians for hundreds of years, many generations, and it is accepted as true without reflection, without even consideration, by an awful lot of people. You will hear people say, I've heard people say, I'm an atheist, I don't believe any of that stuff, but of course, I sent my kid to Sunday school because I wanted him to learn some how to be moral human beings. And I say, are you kidding? But they are sincere. They actually think that is the right thing to do. And they're sort of knee-jerk assuming that religion teaches. Actually, religion does teach moral values. It teaches all kinds of values, some of which I share and some of which I don't. And a moral values voter can be somebody who's very religious. It can also be somebody who thinks separate and independent equal rights for all, whether they're gay or straight, old or young, or ethnic this, ethnic that. That's a strong moral value. They can be people who believe the government has an important role to play in educating children, in child care, all kinds of things that are moral questions. They certainly, people who are religious sometimes have moral values that I share. I don't mean to imply that religion is automatically a disqualifier for what counts as proper moral values, but it's never sufficient basis. And of course, one of the key religious ideas that is associated with morality is that if you're a moral person, you will be obedient to God. You will worship God. That's pretty hard for me to do, since I don't believe the sucker exists. So I got, you know, there are all kinds of political and sociological problems with this whole idea. And I think it needs to be combated. I don't know that we can do that in this book. Maybe we can touch on it. But one of the things we're convinced of is that if this book is going to have any success, and I like the idea of having it supplemented with some nice YouTube videos, it has to be short and punchy. It doesn't have to be insulting. It has to be short and punchy. It has to be something where somebody doesn't feel like they're getting out a college history book and wading through it.
Do you want to do one more, or can?
I did have an idea, although I think some of these other ideas are better. And now that you've expanded a little, I have a better idea of where you're going. Mine is less interesting. But I don't know if there is a secularism for dummies or an atheism for dummies already.
There is an excellent book, Atheism for Dummies. I say excellent because I had something to do with it, although I didn't have much. Dale McGowan wrote Atheism for Dummies, and I was the technical editor or something like that. And I expected to like it and to agree with it and approve of it. What I didn't expect is to learn from it, and I learned a lot from it. It's very well written and very interesting. It does not deal, except just very incidentally, with secularism. I don't know whether there's a secularism for dummies or not, but I think some of the ideas that are used in those series might, in fact, apply very well. If there is a secularism for dummies, we ought to look and find it. Or if there isn't one, we ought to write it. Thank you.